Angina is normally described as a form of chest pain, but rather than being a severe pain, it's a feeling of cramping and constriction in the middle of the chest. And this is lasts a few minutes, typically happens when people begin to exercise, and can go down the arm and into the shoulders and neck and so on. It can be associated with things like sweatiness and shortness of breath. And the usual cause is narrowings in the arteries that provide blood to the heart. Angina happens when the heart's trying to do extra work and the amount of oxygen it gets from the narrowed blood vessels is insufficient to provide for its needs, and it's almost a stitch-like symptom that the heart develops. Angina is usually classified into two different categories, which is stable and unstable. Stable will typically come on when somebody walks a particular distance, lasts a short period of time and goes very quickly with medication. Unstable angina tends to last longer and happens at rest or on very little exertion, and that should be regarded as an emergency and the patient should go to hospital. The proportion of people will present with stable angina, that is due to atherosclerosis in the arteries and narrowings in the arteries, and that progresses and develops over a period of many years, you know, perhaps 20 or 30 years. So it's a very slow changing process, which is the reason why a lot of these patients can be managed with tablets and they're not at high risk. However, the unstable population may present for the first time with a heart attack, and obviously that's a much higher risk situation, and it's impossible to accurately predict at the moment who's going to become unstable from the stable population. The sort of people who get angina it's more common in men, it's more common in some ethnic groups, particularly Asians, and it becomes much more common as people get older. And there's a variety of risk factors that make people, again, more likely to have it, such as smoking or high cholesterol, high blood pressure. Angina is extremely common and gets much more common with age, and it's estimated that perhaps as many as 1 in 5 people over the age of 60 or 65 has some degree of angina. A lot of those people will have relatively mild symptoms and be controlled on tablets, but some obviously will be much more unwell with that. In younger populations, it's much less common, and in women before the menopause, it's much less common. So in terms of medication, the treatment for angina is in three groups. One is to stop the symptoms when they occur, and typically that will be in a form of a spray or a small tablet that goes under the tongue, a nitrate tablet. The next is to try and prevent the symptoms occurring, which will be with medications such as beta blockers, which slow the heart down and reduce the oxygen demand for the heart, and therefore prevent it happening. And there are alternatives for beta blockers, which can't be used in everybody. And the final part of this is to try and prevent any progression of the disease that already exists. And that includes tablets such as aspirin, something to reduce the cholesterol, which is almost always a statin, and various other medication as well. Following the diagnosis, a lot of patients then recommended to have further investigations, which might be a test like an angiogram, which is more specifically look at the inside of the arteries and decide whether or not further treatment is necessary, such as angioplasty or bypass surgery. An angiogram is a test which looks at the inside of the arteries, and the way that's done is to put a tube either in the top of the leg or in the wrist and take a fine catheter up to the heart and put dye around the heart to outline the arteries. And x-rays are taken and that outlines shows you exactly where the narrowings are. Following that, there's several possibilities. One possibility is that you'll be recommended to carry on with tablets. The next possibility is that something called an angioplasty will be done, which is done through the same tube, but involves putting a balloon and a stent, which is a wire mesh to keep the artery open. So that's put in the narrowed area and blown up so that it keeps the artery open. If there's a lot of narrowings or in certain circumstances, then a bypass operation might be recommended, which is a surgical option which involves putting grafts beyond the narrowings to improve the blood flow. There's a lot of things that people can do throughout their life to try and reduce their chance of getting heart disease. It's to do with not smoking, having a good diet, exercise, drinking a moderate, drinking's acceptable but in modest amounts. And the diet thing is, obviously I think we're all aware of what the diet should be. It should be high in fruit and vegetables, relatively low in saturated fats, low in salt. Stable angina itself does not carry a very huge risk, so people shouldn't worry if they've got stable symptoms and pain's lasting a short time. They will be given medication, which is lifelong, and that reduces the risk of anything further happening quite substantially. Unstable angina is a very different category and should be regarded as an emergency.